watching you.
That's comforting.
Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
I shared on House of Prayer night, I had gotten a new book by Jonathan Kahn. A lot of you probably remember a while back, The Harbinger. We passed, or I think we even watched the DVD here.
Yes.
And his new book is called The Book of Mysteries. And it is, it's like not a study book, but yet I find myself learning from it. Because he writes it in such a way that because of his Jewish background and then knowing what we know, I mean, he gives scriptures and it's like a student teacher is kind of how he does it. And there are 365 different lessons. So technically, you could just read one page one day and meditate on that if you wanted. Yeah. But I have been so fascinated with this book, I can't put it down. And so I'm reading multiple pages at a time. But a couple of them that really stuck out, I wanted to share with you guys tonight. It's called Kissing God. There was a gathering in the school's open-air tent. It was a time of worship and praise. We were just outside the tent listening. What do you think of, asked the teacher, when you hear the word worship? Singing, hymns, prayers, words of praise. That's the outward form of worship, he said. That's how worship manifests, but what's the heart of worship? I don't know. I'll give you one definition, a secret. It's found in the New Covenant scriptures. It only appears in the Greek. It's the word proskuneo. And do you know what it means? I had no answer. It means to kiss. True worship, said the teacher, is to kiss. And what does this reveal? What is a kiss? A kiss is the most intimate of acts. Therefore, worship is to be the most intimate thing you can experience. To worship God is to kiss God? In the spiritual realm, yes. To teach from your heart, or to kiss from your heart, from your innermost being. And when you kiss, you don't do it because you have to. You do it freely from your heart because you want to.
Love to.
So true worship is never done by compulsion, but freely from the overflow of your heart. And why does one kiss? Asked the teacher. Because of joy? Yes, he said. A kiss is an expression of joy, and kissing brings you joy. So true worship is an expression of joy. Out of worship, you worship out of joy, and your joy becomes worship, and your worship becomes joy. Teacher, I said, you didn't say the most obvious, which is, one kisses because of love, I said. A kiss is an expression of love. It is. So then what is true worship? Worship is an expression of love. Yes, said the teacher. It's as simple as that. It's the most intimate act of love and worship. Worship is as simple as kissing God. And then at the bottom of each so-called little lesson or class, he gives the mission. Today, draw near to God in worship, in love, in joy, in the deepest of intimacies. Learn the secret of kissing. And then Psalms 42, 7 and 8. Deep calleth unto deep at the noise of thy waterspouts. All thy waves and thy billows are gone over me, yet the Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime. And in the night his song shall be with me, and my prayer unto the God of my life. And the Song of Solomon, 1, verse 2. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for thy love is better than wine. And then John 4:24. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. But I guess I was thinking, you know, she's a prostitute, but, you know, she does those things, but never kisses, because there's something intimate about a kiss. And so I thought it was really cool to know how God really sees worship. I mean, it's the most intimate thing between the bride and the groom, and it brings joy and fulfillment, and it draws you closer to each other. So that was one. And then the other one that really blew me away is this one. There was no lesson that day, but then in the middle of the night, he came to my room and he woke me. "Come," said the teacher, "it's time for the lesson. We're going outside." I was half asleep and not thrilled at the idea, but of course I complied. He led me to a hill where we sat down in the darkness of night. "Which comes first," he said, "the day or the night?" "The day," I answered. "Night comes when the day's over." That's what most people would say, and that's how most people in the world see it. Day leads into night, but that's not how God sees it. "What do you mean?" "If the day leads to night, then everything goes from light to darkness. Everything gets darker. Everything is in the process of darkening. And it would appear to be the way of the world. We go from day to night, from youth to aging, from strength to weakness, and ultimately from life to death. Day to night, it's the way of the world, but it's not the way of God. When God created the universe, it was not day and night. It is written, there is an evening, and then there was morning, and the day began with night. Yes. There was night, and then there was day. It is the night that comes first. So that's why Jewish holidays always begin at sunset? Yes, and not only Jewish holidays, but every biblical day. Each day begins at sunset. There is an evening, and then morning. The world moves from day to night, but in God, it's the opposite. It goes from night to day, from darkness to light. The children of this world live from day to night, but the children of God live from night to day. They are born again in the darkness and move to the day. And if they belong to God, then that is the order of their life. You are to go from darkness to light. From weakness to strength, from despair to hope, from guilt to innocence, from tears to joy, and from death to life. And every night in your life will lead to the dawn. So live according to God's sacred order of time, that your entire life be always moving away from darkness and to the light. And as he said those words, the first light of daybreak appeared, and the night began yielding to the day. The mission, what darkness is in your life, the darkness of fear, of sin, of problems or gloom, today turn away from it and to the light. And then the scriptures for those. You know, I thought it was what God kind of reminded me as I was reading this. You know, it says, that to me, would be something so insignificant. You think, what does it matter? Day, night, night, day, it just is. You know, you don't really give it much thought. And I think that's what we do a lot of times with most of the things in our life. We just think it's insignificant and it really doesn't matter. But there's so many things. I mean, God did everything for a reason and for a purpose. Because if we are walking according to the way he's walking, I mean, like, I used to think repenting was coming to the altar and bawling and squalling and begging and pleading, "Oh God, forgive me, please help me to be better," you know, that kind of thing. And now know that repenting is changing the way you think. It's not just changing the way you think about God, it's changing the way you think about everything. Yeah. So from, it's not day then night, it's night then day. Or like when it talks about going from young to old. No, the scripture says he restores our youth like eagles.
Come on.
It says you go from, what was the other one? It said, guilt to innocence. Well, that's essentially what he did on the cross. Right. I mean, we were in Adam and we were guilty, but he has restored us back to the innocence from the very beginning, which is the way he intended it. And so we have to be really conscious of every single thing that we're thinking about. So those were some of the things that popped into my mind, just because there are so many things that we do each day and don't give it much thought because it doesn't seem like it would matter. But yet he says to renew our minds and to put on the mind of Christ. So there's so much that, you know, it does matter. Yeah. Anyway, Genesis 1:3-5 said, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. Psalms 30:5. For his anger endureth but a moment, and his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Ephesians 5:8. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now ye are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. And then 1 Peter 2:9. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And then 2 Peter 1:19. Ye have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. Anyway, I just wanted to share that because even though it's just a book that, I mean, it's like not a factual book, but yet it has things in it that you can glean from, and with what we know, and then a little bit of his Jewish history comes out in it. I can't get enough of it, so.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you. Yeah.
So, with that, are there any questions, comments, prayer requests?
I've heard of my daughter's death. She's had surgery tomorrow.
Continue to lift up Cindy for completion of her healing, and also Myron.
Yes. Yes.
And Doug. Doug keeps coming to mind, so.
Okay. Does anyone talk to him? I didn't know if he kept in contact with anyone or anything.
I don't have his number.
Okay. Alvin?
I've got a praise report.
Yeah.
I was coming into Waukee tonight, and from a parking lot just close there, I was just driving along, and here come a pickup, and he didn't stop. He just come right on out, and like a hair's breadth, but he didn't make contact, and just wow.
Yeah.
Amen.
Lord had to be in it.
Yes,
that's
right.
Right. That's right.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Anyone else?
Thank you, Lord.
All right, we can stand and just take these to the Lord.
Praise
they're not needs. We're just going to thank him for them because
yes.
He knows the end from the beginning and it's
thank
already
Lord.
Finished.
Yes.
So,
thank you, Lord.
Lord, we come to you,
thank
Lord, and
you,
we thank you, God, that we know what we know, God, that what you did on the cross was finished, God. So we can thank you for the healings that are manifesting, God, that we get to be a part of it, God. As you reveal and manifest your goodness and your glory, God, that we get to be a part of it. We pray that you have your way in this service tonight, God, and that you would move in a mighty way, that as we leave here, that we leave a little bit closer to you, that as we lift up our voices and worship, God, the most intimate, God, thing that you desire, that we kiss you and that we touch your heart as you touch ours with a love, God, that we can't even comprehend, God, that we pray that you would have your way and bless everyone here. Bless those that can't be here tonight for whatever reason, God, that you continue to move in their lives, God, and give us greater wisdom and revelation, God, that we can all be used for your glory. In the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for it. Thank you, Jesus. And I heard something. We can go ahead and speak the word, but you know, people pray, Lord, revive us. We're not supposed to be dead.
Right.
You know, so again, changing the way we think. There's so many different things we say unconsciously and don't think that they have much meaning, but you know, we're supposed to be alive, and we pray for God to come. God come, and God's saying, go! You know, he wants us to go.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, let's speak the word.
Praise the Lord.
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any
Thank you. thank you, Lord, for every good and perfect gift. You are a gracious and loving God. And for that, Lord, we are eternally grateful. And we give you all the thanks and all the praise, for you alone are worthy. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Tammy. And thank you, Suzanne, for the clicker. Praise the Lord. I would just say, you know, generally speaking, and that's kind of where my words for tonight are speaking in terms of general Christianity, and wherever we fall in there, that'll leave that up to you. But I'd say the typical Christian does a lot more handshaking than kissing when it comes to the Lord. So, and a lot of that is simply because we don't really believe that he wants the intimacy with us that he does. And everything about God declares what Tammy was saying tonight, that it talks about kissing the Son, S-O-N. And so God is all about the intimacy and all about our really becoming one, as is symbolized in marriage. And of course, in the wedding ceremony, that once a man and woman have been married, the first thing you do is kiss the bride. And it's not consummating, but it is in the symbolic sense. It's representing all that marriage is about, the two becoming one, and their love and commitment to one another. So with that in mind, let's go to Romans chapter 8, and I'll be brief tonight because it is Wednesday, and I know y'all need to get your sleep. not that you need beauty sleep, but I'm just saying. We've got to have our rest, praise the Lord. Y'all are beautiful to me, praise God. Okay, Romans 8, verses 19 through 22, Mike. Romans 8, 19 through 22. For the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. So, I guess the rhetorical question tonight is, why are most Christians easily satisfied? Oh, I'm sorry. It only has one button on it, so you would think that I could get it there right, but apparently it's not charged because my light's not on. Is this on?
Yeah, it's on.
Talk louder, no problem. So the question then is, why are most Christians easily satisfied, right?
Yeah.
Well, Romans 8 says that it's not just creation, but we ourselves groan.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? But I don't see that much groaning in Christianity. Amen. Praise the Lord. I mean, I find Christians far too easily satisfied with relationship with the Lord. Not that God is demanding more, but that the more we try to establish that relationship, kiss the Son, you know, kiss God, have that intimacy, the more we are translated or transformed into that image. So I think I know why. I think we often misunderstand our faith, and we put all of the weight on conversion, getting somebody saved or getting saved ourselves, amen? And then we have very little expectation for what's going to come after that. All of the pressure, all of the emphasis, all of our energies are put into getting saved, having God deliver us and so forth, and seeing that happen in other people. So what happens is we come to know the Lord, and we're sincere about it, I'm not saying that, but then our love for God's grace is replaced starts with gratitude, but it's easily and naturally then turns to payback
yeah. right.
a debt
right.
that we owe because of his goodness. In other words, we're trying to earn his grace. And then from that point on, we move into the self-salvation projects, which is, you know, what every church has and basically emphasizes. So we need to ask, what moves me towards Jesus? It's a personal question for each one of us. And what stirs my affections for the Lord? I mean, if you think about it in a natural way, I mean, it's not hard to figure out what attracts you to another person. Then what holds your attraction to that person, personality, you know, interaction, the closer you become to one another, the more you know of each other, the more you understand each other, the more free you are with each other, the more open you can be with each other. All of those things are part of the relationship. But let's look at this in 2 Timothy 1, verses 6 through 9. 2 Timothy 1, 6 through 9. So we need to realize we're emotional people, and God said he's moved by the feelings, you know, and infirmities that we have, the weaknesses that we have, and the feelings, the emotions that we have. So what stirs our emotion to him? Wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Praise God. On through to 8 and 9, please. And be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. So what is it that stirs you up? What is it that stirs you up to know him more deeply than just the salvation message, or just being born again, or just knowing that God cares about me, or that God has done something to provide for me? What stirs us to know him, to love him, and to kiss him, to worship him? Amen. Amen. And it'll probably look different for different people.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Like any relationship, they're unique. They're one of a kind. You know, you can't really fabricate yours based on somebody else's. You want the intimacy with God. You don't want to voyeuristic kind of relationship. You want a one-on-one, a one-to-one, an intimate gift that's called grace that leads then to this intimacy of relationship with God. All right? Galatians chapter 3, verses 1 through 11, Mike. Galatians 3, 1 through 11. O foolish Galatians, who have bewitched you that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth, crucified among you. This only would I learn of you. Receive ye the spirit of the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? Are ye so foolish, having begun in the spirit, are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Have ye suffered so many things in vain, if it be yet in vain? He therefore that ministereth to you the spirit, and worketh miracles among you, doeth it by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? Even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same were the children of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. What was the gospel? He preached grace to Abraham. It was by faith that Abraham was saved. It wasn't because of works that he'd done, because there were no laws. I mean, there wasn't a law given at that time. It was all by the grace of God. So then they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse, for it's written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. But that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident, for the just shall live by faith. Praise the Lord. So if we're living life in pursuit of Jesus, as opposed to a gospel-denying pursuit of self-improvement, we have to answer those questions in a way that push us further into the gospel,
mm-hmm.
not further into religion, not further
yes.
into self-works.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to go deeper into the gospel, deeper into the grace of God, deeper
yes.
into the love
yes.
of God, and not further into legalism.
Amen.
So what's the worst thing that we can do in figuring out what stirs us or what quenches us. And I'd suggest to you this evening that it's more religion. You should do this, or you should do that, or not do the other. You should follow our rules, our regulations. But we just read that that's all vanity. That's all, it puts us under a curse.
Right.
It separates us from the love of God.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it does.
That's not glorying in Christ, but it's glorying in our behavior.
Yes, it is.
Amen. So Philippians chapter 3, verse 8, Mike. Philippians 3 and 8. Yea, doubtless I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. So here's Paul, the Pharisee of Pharisees, the keeper of every rule and regulation, the dotting of all I's and crossing of all T's, saying that's all crap. It's rubbish.
Yes.
And it's to be discarded. It's to be thrown away, right?
Right.
Because yep. Without, that's the only way that, if I don't count them as rubbish, I can't have the intimacy with Christ that I'm longing for, that everything in me is desiring. Amen. So suddenly, you've turned the pursuit of Jesus into the same badge of honor that Paul says should be thrown away.
Yeah.
Considered it garbage.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, we start to worship. Instead of worshiping God, we're worshiping the thing.
Yes.
Right.
The thing itself rather than the goal, rather than what it is we're after. It's like, it's like affair after affair after affair. Never getting to the love. Never getting to the real relationship.
Right.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? I'm not trying to be crude, but I'm just saying it's like looking for love in all the wrong places, but it's trying to satisfy this deep hunger and longing that can only be satisfied in true love, in a true intimate relationship.
Yes.
Right.
Amen. It's like you said with Pretty Woman. I've never seen the whole show, although I'm a great fan of Julie Roberts and Richard Gere for that matter, I guess. But you know, it's odd to think that kissing is the most intimate thing.
Yeah.
But in a way, it is.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Because it's really more than just a sexual act, which can just become a physical thing,
sure.
You know, to substitute for the real intimacy. And that's what God is saying. I mean, throughout the scripture, you read that about adultery, you know, committing adultery against God. And yet God is saying, look, I want the pure love.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I want real love. I want the kiss.
Yes.
You know, I want you, not your body, not your... You know, not something that's just self-satisfying or gratifying, but I want you.
Yes.
Right.
I want your commitment. I want to be committed to you. I want you committed to me. Amen?
Amen.
So, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now what he's saying here, let's read it one more time. We all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So what that is saying to me is that's getting rid of the baggage.
Yeah.
It's getting rid of the religious baggage or otherwise that distract us from him.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
That makes sense to you.
Right.
It's the attraction to him, not to the stuff surrounding him, not to the religion, not to things that we do, but the attraction is to him and him alone. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. All right. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. All of these other things that we think, you know, we're doing to make us closer to God are actually distractions.
Yeah.
Right.
They're not... The focus is not on our intimacy with him, but it's in doing stuff that makes intimacy even more difficult, actually.
Mm-hmm.
So, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus has broken the bonds, the bands, the restrictions, and everything that has held us back. And he set us free to kiss God. Lay aside every weight, everything, every thought of our, you know, unsuitability, our unacceptance, unacceptability, you know, all of those. Just lay aside all of that. And the sin that does so easily beset us, what's the sin that does so easily beset us? Trying to do stuff to make ourselves acceptable instead of just embracing the fact that God loves us just like we are and that we can love him in return.
Yes.
Praise God. So Jesus has broken those bonds that have kept us back and has set us free. He's given us power by his Spirit. So run.
Yeah.
Amen? Make a break for it.
Amen.
Pursue him.
Yes.
And only him. With passion, with fire, with force, with oomph, as we say. Why? To know him.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
To know him intimately.
Yes.
As the scripture implies that Abraham knew Sarah, you know, and on and on and on. That's what it's talking about. It's this coming together. It's this oneness. It's this marriage. It's the culmination of what salvation did. I would say it like this. The day you're saved, it's like the betrothal, it's like the wedding.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But God wants to consummate it.
Yes.
Right.
But we have to have intimacy to do it. We have to get closer. We have to. He isn't just looking for somebody to go to bed with. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
He's looking for a bride.
Yes.
He's
right.
Looking for someone for life. You know,
yes.
Something that goes beyond that. Not
yes.
Not that there's anything wrong with that, but that's not the goal. That's not the purpose. The purpose is that two become one.
Yes.
Right.
Amen. Philippians chapter 3, verse 12. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ.
Yes.
So why pursue? Because we're broken. Because we fail. Because we question, because we struggle, because we're afraid sometimes. Ephesians 1, verses 4 through 6. It's like, I'll just say it from my perspective. You're out someplace, I mean, not recently, obviously, but and you're just around, and some beautiful woman just comes up and starts talking to you. And you go, wait a minute, what's wrong with this picture? There's got to be a flaw in this chick. Or she ain't going to be hitting on me, right? I mean, she's beautiful. You know what I'm saying? And that's kind of the way we are with God. We start looking for reasons that this can't be happening.
Right.
It's too good. You know, we undermine it. It's like, have you seen any of these commercials where the guys, this one in particular is comical. I don't even know what the commercial is. I don't know what they're selling. I just know that it's funny. So this guy and his girlfriend are laying on... And they're like, oh, it's a spray. It's a body. Sometimes you just need a shh. So he's laying out in the grass with this beautiful young gal, and he's just talking, and he said, you look so beautiful. He said, you remind me of your mother. She's really hot, you know. And of course, the girl's going, what the heck, you know? That's the way we are.
Yeah.
You know, we're like, we're stupid. We don't know when to shut up and just receive the love that God has for us, you know. We undermine the thing that he's trying to provide for us. That's probably a bad analogy, but it worked for me. Praise the Lord. Okay, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love, having predestinated us under the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved.
Amen.
So we pursue because he won't let us go.
Right.
He won't give up on us. He's got us. We want to get him.
Yes.
I mean, that's the idea. He has loved us into loving him.
Yes.
Our response is what's critical. You're not going to change his love. You're not going to change the love of God. You're not going to change the intimacy that he desires with us. All we can do is fulfill it.
Right. Right.
And for that, we have to pursue him as
yes.
he has pursued us.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Ephesians 1, verse 7. Next verse. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. His grace is so rich. It's so complete. It's so total. Amen. We can either chase him or what? Like the disciples, to whom would we go? We're just chasing our own tail. We're just running in circles. If we're not chasing him, we're chasing a phantom. We're chasing a zephyr. We're chasing something that can't be caught or possessed. Don't stop. Keep pressing on. He laid hold of you, and he won't let go so that you can lay hold of him.
Yes.
Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give him a hand tonight. Praise God. Amen, amen. God bless you. He's pursuing us and continues to pursue us our entire life. Before we're saved, till we're saved, after we're saved. And he's asking us, pursue me.
Amen.
I'm right here. I'll never leave you or forsake you. There's always more. There's always a deeper, more intimate relationship that can be had in him if we just continue to pursue him and not religion. Amen.
Amen.
God bless all of you. Appreciate you being here tonight. Have a great rest of the week. Hope we'll see you here Sunday. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.